speaking about international legal instruments as such, what exactly is happening at international level? What are the type of legislations that are present? When we speak about climate change laws in specifically, the entire genesis for climate laws comes from international covenants, international treaties, and those aspects. In fact, the first conference, the first World Climate Conference, was held in Geneva in 1979. Now, today, when we see, this is 42 years. After 42 years, we have made a very, very good amount. We have spent a good amount of time, and today we are in the process of bringing out climate change specific legislations. Now, these are not legislations on any specific subject matter, but it's a legislation on entire climate itself. Now, this was not imagined some 40 years ago. If I'm not wrong, in 1979, when the world first conference, climate conference, was held, it was declared that there is a variability in climate. So, and today when we see, we know that there is a climate change, which is a reality. Many countries have passed legislations with respect to climate change, be it UK or Germany. So if we compare these 40 years of journey, we can say that international community, led by many governments, led by many international organizations like United Nations and other organizations, many philanthropists who have funded for these particular programs and made sure that these particular climate change related aspects are mitigated as soon as possible. And if I'm not wrong, in today's time, we have already seen what can be the devastating effect of climate change. We have very good predictive models which can speak about what the kind of changes that we'll see with 1 degree Celsius average increase in the planet's temperature, then 1.5 degrees, then 2 degrees, then 3 degrees. So we have predictable models with good accuracy. And we have also seen some devastating effects of climate change, like a rise in the sea level, and which is definitely going to affect islands which are at lower levels when compared to sea level. When we look at the climate change aspect, from 1979, then we had in 1988 the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, was formed, which brought out its first assessment report. Now, this is a very unique body which specifically deals with climate change. Now, they do all kind of scientific research. They predict, they take the help of technology with scientific assessment. They bring out a report. And so far, they have brought out 6 reports. And in fact, when you look at the first report, based on the first report, there was a clear consensus among the members of that particular body that climate change is real. In fact, and the same was reiterated in subsequent conferences also of 97 and 2002 also. What we can see is the first assessment report. Based on this assessment report, the United Nations again came up with a new body, which is the present one, the United Nations Panel on Climate Change, which conducts the COP programs, the conference of parties across the finding out different places and conducting conferences and making sure that the parties, the countries, member countries, come to a particular agreement on reducing the emissions, be it greenhouse gases, or making sure that the temperature, the global temperature, does not cross 1.5 degrees or 2 degrees Celsius, which is more or less like a dangerous line. And if it is crossed, then it will have a exponential nature. If we look at the 1992 conference, also called as the Earth Summit, the Rio conference, this was the first time when United Nations Convention on Climate Change was proposed. And in the same conference, there was also a proposal for beginning United Nations Conference on Biodiversity. So this particular conference was very important. And subsequently, we had conferences in 97, the Earth Plus Summit, Earth Summit Plus. Then we had World Climate Conference in Kyoto. And this was the first time when the member countries, they started ratifying and started accepting their responsibility. For example, US pledged to reduce their emissions by 7%, and then EU said it would do by 8%. Japan said for 6%. The member countries which ratified, they started working towards reducing targets. And in a way, this was one major, if you ask me, one major achievement to bring together member countries and making sure that they are accepting this. Now, if you then we had again 2002, we had a Delhi conference. Then we had in 2012, and most famous, we had in 2015 Paris Agreement. So if you look at the journey from 1979 in the first climate conference, World Climate Conference, and if you look at today, the COP26, 42 years have passed, and there has been a lot of journey for with regard to climate change. Now, what are the specific climate change laws that have been brought in by different countries? Now, this one aspect is wherein not much has been done by member countries, barring few countries and some states. There are specific legislation for climate change. This one lagging area, we can say. But if you see from 1997 to 2012, indeed, you can say that as per the reports of climatelaws.org, there has been 30 times increase in legislations related to climate and environment. Now, this is one positive aspect. Some of them are directly related to climate and reduction in the greenhouse gases. Some are with respect to air pollution, water pollution, wildlife protection, with regard to biodiversity. Now, overall, if you see from 1997 to 2020, for 164 countries, there is an increase from 60 to 1800 laws and policies clubbed together. Now, this is something which is encouraging, though we may not accept looking at the climate change that we are seeing. This may be very less, but then having said that, bringing the entire international community and member states to one place and making sure that they follow these ratified declarations, and they are going back and making domestic laws based on these international instruments and laws, that itself is an achievement, and no doubt a lot has to be done in future also. Now, if we look at the case of important climate change legislations done at international level, we can see United Kingdom. Now, UK has brought in UK Climate Change Act in 2008. Now, this particular act, this is one of the earliest known climate change laws which has observed across the globe. This particular act, this brings out a legally binding mitigation goals. Now, there are n number of mitigation measures that has to be taken up as per this law, and they have set a target also. Now, they brought out a target of reducing the greenhouse gas emissions by 80%. By 2050, keeping in mind the 1990 levels. Okay, now this is this was way back in 2008, 13 years ago. UK has done it, and as recently in 2019, they have again rechanged it to having a net zero emissions by 2050. Now this is very ambitious, and I really hope it is done. Now, if you look at this UK Climate Change Act, now this particular act has both long-term and short-term targets to achieve these particular measures of emissions. Now, another important aspect in this particular act is that it has an independent advisory body, which is called as the Committee on Climate Change. And the main purpose of this body is to advise the government and the parliament on carbon budgeting. Now, this is very unique, carbon budgeting, which has been observed for last more than a decade now, a couple of decades. Many countries are taking up carbon budgeting. They are trying to gather funds for these kind of setup. Some have a separate climate budget, some countries, and some countries are trying to shift the annual budget fiscal budget into a more climate friendly budget. So all kind of measures and national policies are gathered, directed towards a climate budget. Now there is another important aspect in the UK Climate Change Act is National Adaptation Program to manage unavoidable climate change effects. Now earlier I was talking about mitigation plans. Now this act also has adaptation programs. If there are any specific climate change disasters which are occurring in UK, so they have an adaptation program. So yeah, so this is in general what UK has brought in 2008, and in 2019 again they amended, and they are now trying for net zero emissions by 2050. Now another country which I would like to emphasize is on Mexico. Now Mexico is an emerging country, and similar to India, it is also one of the growing developing economy. Now Mexico brought a climate change legislation which is called the General Law on Climate Change in 2012, after 4 years of UK brought this particular legislation. And this law, unlike in UK, this particular law, what this brought was an institutional structure for fighting climate change. Now there was an institutional structure and a coordination and decision making body which will advise all the aspects of mitigation, adaptation for reaching our targets for Mexico. Now in fact this is the first large oil producing nation to bring out such legislation on climate change. Now they have brought in, through this particular law, they have brought in a national system on climate change which will have Interministerial Commission on Climate Change, the first body. Then they will have another body named as Climate Change Council, and then National Institute for Ecology and Climate Change. Now these bodies form the basic pillars for their fight towards climate change, and these particular bodies will have members from their federal congress, that is their central body of government, and then members from state governments and also municipal authorities. Now if you look at Mexico, the basic difference between Mexico and UK is that when the act was brought in by both these countries, the structural and the institutional mechanism for Mexico is very strong, and whereas for UK it is more of an advisory kind of a body. But another difference that we can see in both of these is, for UK the emission targets are binding in nature for the entire country, but whereas for Mexico they have made it conditional on the support of international community. Now how are we going to achieve the targets in this particular scenario is a very big task. Achieving for UK is somewhat easy because it is binding for them, but for Mexico it is a bit challenge. The Mexicans have set target of 30% emission by 2020. This was way back in 2012 when the act was enacted. But now they have, at the same time, they have also planned for 50% reduction by 2050 emissions. Now, Mexico said a very interesting point in their particular law, which was business as usual. They never specified any target as such, I mean a level. For example, UK said from 1990 levels, but Mexico has said that 30% of the business, I mean what was happening at that time, they will reduce by 30%. But for 2050, their target, they said we will reduce by 50%. That will be based on 2000 levels, but not 1990, which usually other countries take up. Now this is the basic difference between the kind of structure, the law that was passed by UK, and then the same was passed by similar one passed by Mexico. Now when we move on, we can see Germany. Germany had passed a federal climate change law in recently in 2019, and this was completely based on the Germany's commitment to the Paris Agreement, 2015 Paris Agreement, and as such, they have aimed at limiting the their entire support for this entire climate change will be to limit the global temperature, keeping it below 2 degrees centigrade and possibly between below 1.5 degree centigrade. Now, when we compare all these aspects and when we come to India. In India, we don't have any specific climate change legislation as such. One climate change bill was introduced in Lok Sabha in 2015, in fact, by MP Shri Kailash Narayan Singh. And the main crux of the this particular bill, which was introduced in Lok Sabha, was to reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases and to set a target for that and then to set up a national committee to establish a national committee on climate change to take further actions based on the recommendations of that particular community and further to introduce carbon budgeting and carbon trading scheme. Now, this was brought in 2015 and still nothing has moved forward in this particular aspect and we are still waiting for any future legislations in this particular aspect, which has to be done up as soon as possible and in a speedy manner. Now, when we look at now for any country to move forward before enacting any specific legislations with regard to climate change. Now, what is the experience that we gathered at international level and at different countries when they have enacted. Now we have climate change legislations for nearly 1.5 decades in the world. Now what exactly have we learned and what are the important features that we need to have so that we may proceed further while enacting any climate change related framework legislation. Now one crucial thing that I can see is targets. Now since 1990s, targets have played a very crucial role in mobilizing countries, member states to accept legislations. For example, to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, member countries have committed there. For example, India, based on the powers under the EP Act, the central government had enacted for a reduction of this one, greenhouse gas emissions. This was done in, I think it was done in the year 2000 or 2002. So whenever there is a target which has been provided to any member state, now countries take up very aggressively. Some countries, emerging economies or developing countries, they have their own domestic compulsions with regard to energy policy of energy. But having said that, the situation throughout the world has come to a stage wherein we cannot compromise or we cannot rely on the domestic compulsions. The global climate change phenomena is real and it requires a specified targets at global level and also at member state level and also regional level within the country. Now it can be both long-term goal, we can say 2030, 2050 or 2070. We can say intermediary or medium-term goals. Apart from that, the framework legislation on climate change should also have mitigative measures and adaptive measures. Now, mitigative measures is very essential because when we look at the climate change aspect, the main contribution is anthropogenic, human-induced activities, be it industrialization or post-industrialization world. Now, this has largely contributed to the whatever problem that we are facing as of now. So if we say then we need to mitigate. Now taking mitigation measure is a very big thing because it directly affects many countries, the economy. For example, the classic case of reducing the greenhouse gases like chlorofluorocarbons and fluorocarbons. In 90s, it was decided to reduce the emission so as to protect ozone layer. Now, ozone layer is again one major. If there is a thinning of ozone layer in the atmosphere, there is direct impact of UV rays on Earth, which definitely increases the temperature. Now, there was the international community and the many national governments saw this and took mitigative measures to reduce the chlorofluorocarbons from the atmosphere. And to a large extent, we have succeeded in reducing the greenhouse gases, mainly the fluorocarbons. No doubt carbon dioxide is still there. So mitigation loss are very essential, and then adaptation related loss. If there are climate induced or climate change induced disasters, how are our cities going to, or how are our legislations or laws going to help countries and people at large to cope with these? These kind of adaptive measures are also indeed needed, so that our we are ready whenever such problems or climate induced problems are coming to us, we are ready with adaptive measures. And then there shall be periodic assessment of climate risks and vulnerabilities, and there shall be an institutional mechanism for all kinds of scientific researching and bringing out data, real-time data, and then independent advices and coordinations. Then another crucial aspect is we need to create fund whenever we want to fight climate change. Whenever a country doesn't have a dedicated fund for these particular kind of aspects, then we need to create a fund, and the same has to be institutionalized. We can have a climate change fund, it's a classic name, so it can be used, or we can have anything. And but the best, for me personally, I think the best way forward is to have a dedicated climate change fund in the annual budget itself. Now this will institutionalize the fight against climate change for a long time. For example, we have a separate ministry for every aspect, and everyone has their own kind of fund. So similarly, a dedicated fund can be provided in the regular budget, in the annual budget, fiscal budgets. Now, another important aspect will be engaging all the crucial stakeholders, whether it be government, whether it be civil society, corporations, corporate houses, or any concerned citizens. So we need to engage people, we need to engage philanthropists, we need to engage all the relevant stakeholders, so that this particular framework legislations can be taken forward, and at the same time, the result that we are trying to achieve, the targets that we are trying to achieve, to bringing down the global average temperature below 1.5 or 2, this is achieved. So this coordination and among stakeholders, and this is a must. So these are some of the basic features that we can say that as that are very much essential in a climate change related legislations. Now if we can see, there are some international organizations that have come up with very beautiful declarations with regard to certain legal principles. Now there is one such declaration of 2014, which is International Law Association Declaration of Legal Principles Related to Climate Change. Now this particular declaration has got 10 articles. I'll not go into details of all the ones, but only few of them. For example, in this particular declaration, in draft Article 3, it talks about the characterizes the climate system as a common natural resource. Now this is very unique. Usually what we see is we talk about sustainable development, which usually talks about inter and intra-generational equity, sustainable development. Now here we are talking about climate system as a common natural resource for the benefit of present and future generations. Now this is one unique aspect that I saw in this particular declaration. Similarly, we also have Oslo Principles on Climate Change Obligations, which was given in 2015. Now, I would like to conclude by saying only one thing. There is a major challenge in adapting, or let us say bringing out these particular international framework, what are the major salient features, into a domestic law. Now, countries, some countries, developed countries, are able to do in a much better and a quick manner, and some developing countries are still facing challenges owing to a domestic political consumptions their economic status and these aspects, other aspects. Now, this has to be seen in a very urgent manner if we want to bring out climate-specific legislations at international level in all the countries. I don't want to say that not even a single country is left behind. All the countries should be there, and they should have these kind of specific legislation. So there should be a renewed particular effort in this direction, and there should be a global consensus also on supporting these countries by providing them, let us say, clean technology or other aspects, again, which is a controversial aspect, which I don't want to get deeper into. So the countries have to be supported for bringing these kind of legislations based on their economic reality, based on their domestic compulsions, but at the same time, looking at the climate change. Now, because the climate change is here, it is real, and we need to act. I once again thank Council for Green Revolution and the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present myself in this particular topic. Thank you.